We are just 5 days away from a huge election that could change what policing looks like in Minneapolis.
And developing this morning, the group behind the push for change is responding to controversial comments made by the head of the city's police department.
As your chief of police, I would not be in favor of this ballot amendment.
Minneapolis Police Chief Arradondo not holding back on the ballot question that would replace the Minneapolis Police Department with a Department of Public Safety. His biggest issue, two words included in question two on the ballot, that the new department would include police officers if necessary.
I've lived long enough in this life to know that we need courageous men and women who will sacrifice themselves to rush into harm's way to protect fellow citizens. Why those two words were even thought of to be included in that ballot, that is concerning.
And now, yes for Minneapolis, the group pushing for the change, releasing this statement.
Minneapolis Police Chief Arradondo, campaigning in uniform, an explicit contradiction of the policy he himself wrote last year.
City sources confirmed there were several internal and external ethics complaints made following the press conference, accusing Arradondo of using city resources to give a campaign message. Detail. Yes for Minneapolis say they agree with one thing Chief Arradondo believes, Minneapolis is flatlining, but differ on how to fix the problem.
And we ask too much of our police officers, all because our current approach to public safety is not working. It's not working for police officers and not for Minneapolis residents.
If you have questions about what will be on your ballot, we have voter guides for both Minneapolis and St. Paul posted in the featured section of care11.com. This morning, we're also following major news out of the St. Paul Police Department.
Yeah, that major news concerns the chief there. Danny Spiewak brings us up to speed on the big shakeup on the way for St. Paul Police.
St. Paul Police Chief Todd Axtell has announced that he will not seek a second term as police chief beyond his current six-year term that ends in June of 2022. He has not said exactly why he's deciding not to seek a second term, but he's not the first chief in Minnesota to move in a different direction. We're told by the Chiefs Association in this state that more than 30 chiefs have retired since the start of 2021. That's an increase from last year. And nationwide, the Major Cities Chiefs Association reports that almost half of their members, 40 of 79 chiefs, have departed since 2020.
We could be just a week away from kids 5 to 11 being able to get the COVID vaccine. FDA advisors are recommending it to the full FDA. They plan to meet in the coming days before giving final approval. Then next week, a CDC panel will meet to discuss it. They'll then make a recommendation to the CDC director, who gets the final say. When or if that happens, MDH Commissioner Jan Malcolm is outlining how Minnesota will handle the rollout to families who want it. They are expected to vaccinate hundreds of thousands of children and beef up COVID reporting in schools.
This more detailed breakdown, we hope, will give parents, students, and teachers more specific information about what's happening in their local school.
It is possible your child could get a shot the first week of November. The two shots are given 3 weeks apart, so it's a tight timeline to get both shots before Thanksgiving. And remember, a person becomes fully vaccinated 2 weeks after a second shot. So that means your kid needs their second shot by December 10th to be fully vaccinated by Christmas.
Well, it is slow moving on any more people getting vaccinated. According to the vaccine dashboard this morning, 58% of people 12 to 15 years old, they have started their vaccine series. You can see 74.6% of those 16 and older have at least a shot. MDH reporting 31 more people also died yesterday, and now the state has passed that 8,600 total deaths mark since we began tracking this back in March of 2020. The state also reported more than 1,800 new cases yesterday, and it should help this two-week moving average we've been seeing here. It's continuing to go down. That's good news. It's just above 3,000 cases per day right now.
Now here's a look at today's other top stories in your morning rush. A woman is dead after a house exploded on Lake Vermillion. It's a second home explosion in Minnesota since the weekend. Investigators say two people were at the home when it blew up. A woman's body was found inside, and the homeowner was airlifted to a hospital with serious injuries. Officials are still trying to figure out what caused the explosion. Just days ahead of Kyle Rittenhouse's trial, a judge says the three men shot in Kenosha cannot be called victims. Rittenhouse is accused of killing two people during protests following the shooting of Jacob Blake. Depending on whether Rittenhouse's defense team can back it up, the men shot can be called rioters, looters, or arsonists. The trial begins Monday. A new campaign in Minnesota is trying to get more innovators and inventors to the state. It's called Build What Matters. Governor Walz says this is the perfect time for the campaign as we work to bounce back from the pandemic. Minnesota is home to many creations like Nerf footballs, pace packers, and hearing aids. You can visit joinminnesota.com for more. Employees at the Animal Humane Society are getting a nice long break. Starting tomorrow, shelters across the metro will close their doors through November 9th. It's an effort to prioritize the well-being of the staff after a challenging year and a half. Thanks to many adoptions recently, shelters are housing less animals right now, which gives them a chance to take this break. And that's your Thursday Morning Rush.
Your time now, 6:08. Sunrise is live from our nation's capital this morning, where President Biden is delaying his departure to meet with the world's wealthiest countries in Italy in a last-ditch effort to reach a deal on two multi-trillion dollar spending bills. Now, Biden, he wants Democrats to reach an agreement before he gets on a plane. So right now, big ticket items are on the chopping block. The biggest that will directly impact both you and me, family and medical paid leave. Now, paid leave was dropped following objections from two moderate Senate Democrats, Senator Joe Manchin, who's not a fan of how the money's being spent, and Senator Kyrsten Sinema, who isn't sure how to raise the money needed to get a deal done. Right now, there's a new proposal to tax some of the wealthiest Americans known as the billionaire tax, targeting the richest of rich like Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk. But that's also getting some pushback from Senator Manchin. Now, dropping the paid leave is a huge blow to Democrats who say it was one of the key components to Biden's agenda. And it's even a bigger blow to working women and their families. And take a look at this chart. According to a Pew Research study, the U.S. is the only country among 41 nations that does not mandate any paid leave for parents. As you can see, we are at the way very bottom of this list. Not good. Some lawmakers are hoping, though, to get paid leave back in the bill. And Democrats need to support all 50 Democratic senators for this bill to pass.
Amazing that our country is at the bottom of that list.
Yeah, you know, I mean,
disappointing.
Yeah, disappointing. Yeah, that's,
I think,
the word.
Is the word. But you know, there's a lot of things that people, that the Democrats are giving up in this. I mean, talk about paid family leave. We talk about community
free college is off too. Yeah,
and those two Democratic politicians. I mean, they are playing politics here. They're trying to walk a thin line of, you know, appeasing the party, but also appeasing their states they're in, which are mainly red.
All right, let's head over for a live look now over a wet Minneapolis now. And yeah, Guy is out in the Carolina backyard, also wet out there. And Guy, I saw a little wind as I was looking out at you in the backyard there.
Oh yeah, you can expect a little wind. Now, good news though, not as breezy as yesterday morning, if you remember, in the past couple of days. But yeah, you know, you can expect a little wind. Rain coming down from the skies here, not sideways, so that's good. That's a good indicator that we don't have any wind gusts out here. So yeah, that was a good observation by Gia. All right, let's go right into radar. You can see those showers coming down, pretty much widespread. I am starting to see some dry slots developing, though, towards the western part of the state. Now, as I zoom into the metro, unfortunately, you know, not the case for the metro, as still looks to see some widespread rain, but still some dry slots developing off to the south and west. I'll continue to watch that as dry air starts to pump in, but still most of us finding that light rain. Pavement forecast, wet throughout the day, 46, feels like 42. Winds out of the east southeast around 8 miles per hour. Bus stop forecast will show wet conditions this morning, so get ready for a wet bus stop. You'll see a high of 49 today, light rain, a little patchy fog possible. Rain tapers tonight late, 43 for the low. And then getting into tomorrow, you'll see those temperatures, yeah, a little warmer with a few clouds to start and a sunnier finish as well. So here's a look at your 7-day forecast. 56 on Saturday, the warmest day of the seven. Sunday, 46 for Halloween. Monday, 44, you'll see some chilly sunshine.
Sunrisers, we hope you're ready for more Olympics. The 2022 Beijing Winter Games are less than 100 days away, and we have got a treat for you coming up.
Yes, indeed. In 4 minutes, Miracle Mike Garuzioni joins us live to talk about the greatest upset in sports history. You don't want to miss it.
Plus, pictures are worth a thousand words, and apparently a sentimental tweet is worth World Series tickets. You gotta see how this mom scored.